Dr. Trevor Milton, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Trevor Milton is an associate professor of sociology and criminal justice here at Queensborough Community College. He's worked with at-risk populations for over 20 years. His research interests span prison reform, adolescent criminal behavior, urban ethnography, and class and racial identity. He's the author of Overcoming the Magnetism of Street Life and co-author of The Con Men, Hustling in New York City. Dr. Milton is also a podcaster, so find him online and tune into his podcasts. And currently he's producing Modern Racism, a documentary which explores America's efforts to repair the damage caused by institutional racism. And we will talk about that. But Trevor, I want to start off by asking you about ethnography. What is it that ethnographers do?
Now, I really like this question because I was just dealing with this the other day. Ethnography is, in short, it's like the anthropological study of culture. Ethnography usually involves hands-on experience. The way that I explain it to my students is like, it's you as the researcher are going into an environment in order to experience it for yourself. And what you gain out of that is your own experience in an environment that you've never been in. So ethnography absolutely involves going to somewhere and being amongst the people of a culture. And generally, it's just field work.
So different from a journalist who perhaps observes from a bit of a distance, ethnographers get a lot closer to the subject and to the top of interest?
I would say so, because this is interesting, because like in my graduate school program, this was like a question on my dissertation, my PhD exams, what is the difference between journalism and sociology? And journalism usually likes to take a snapshot of something, you know, usually just be a quick snapshot of something. And sociology involves a lot more depth and analysis. You might be studying the exact same thing, but the idea is to go a few layers deeper.
Over a period of time, right?
Over a much longer period of time, right? Like good ethnography usually involves like a year in an environment. I mean, you can be in and out of that environment, but you want to go back and study it for a year or so.
So you get both a bird's eye view, but you also get a very intimate profile.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and I like the idea of that juxtaposition between that ground level view where you're seeing the very fine details of things, but also that sociological analytical view where you gain that helicopter view, as you say, and I also say, in order to gain a greater understanding of what's happening.
Journos run the risk of getting too close to their subjects and losing their objectivity. Do ethnographers have that same sort of risk?
The risk is there. The risk is absolutely there. It kind of just depends, right? Like you have an audience member, you have a reader that might say something to the effect of like, you've gotten too close, you're making them into... you know, you're turning criminals into angels. There was, to be quite honest, with the Con Men book, there was some people criticized it for that like you're making these people into like, this was the criticism. It was almost like you're making them into regular people, but they're criminals. And I was like, well, no, they're not criminals. They're regular people who engage in crime. Like that was the whole point of the book, was to try to gain an understanding of how your average person can land in that same spot that a lot of our subjects were in the Con Men book. So these were con artists, but there were still people at one point, you know.
Since you raised that book, let me ask you about Alibi Jones. Do I have his name right?
Sure. Yep.
Okay. One of the main characters, real people in your book, a bit of a philosopher.
Yes.
Just to set up a little bit for us, who Alibi Jones was, and what drew you to this character?
Okay. Well, Alibi was actually a respondent for my co-author, Terry Williams, okay, whom he had known for years. Terry had met Alibi through his sister, I believe, and they had known each other. They'd kind of been in similar social circles for years. And eventually Terry approached him and said, like, listen, you've told me about these con games that you're involved in. I'd like to learn more about them. Are you willing to show me around? Are you willing to show me some of the tricks that you do?
And these are the guys on the streets of New York City, right?
Oh, yeah. This was all New York City. is interesting. Originally, the book was supposed to be titled The New York City Guide to Cons and Hustles. Like, we almost wanted to make it like a tourist package, like to give it like a tourist flair.
You spent a long time with those individuals. And one thing I read in the book was, I guess, a common denominator of a lot of your characters was that the American dream was beckoning to a lot of these people, but wasn't within their reach. There was a fair amount of struggle in their backgrounds, but they didn't have the opportunity or the access that they needed.
Yeah, what we said in the book was that the American dream was the greatest con job of all. That, you know, we're all told that is, you know, if you work hard, anyone can be wealthy in this culture. And with our research subjects, and really from anybody that grows up in this country, you find out that it's not as easy as just working hard. So you had a lot of people who are taking alternative routes and entering the informal economy in order to survive. Still aiming for that dream, though.
We work at Queensborough Community College with a lot of first generation Americans, a lot of families who are pursuing that American dream, and education is supposed to be that great equalizer in this equation. So can you talk to me a little bit about the work that you do directly with students at Queensborough? What do you teach our students and subject areas that you spend time with?
This is great. I like that you started it with the first generation thing. There's myself, I'm a first generation college student in my family. And so I feel very connected to my students. I feel like I can relate to them very well. We recognize that our students have families. Some of them have kids. A lot of them have full-time jobs. A lot of them, it's very difficult. And probably one of the main things that a main way that I connect with my students is that I recognize that a lot of them are on right on the cusp of saying to themselves, I quit. This is not for me. I'm gonna get out of here. And I feel like my job is to be like, no, like, stay. Like, this is for you. This is an opportunity for you to grow. This is an opportunity for you to progress. Don't give up so easy. So beyond that, you know, I teach in the social sciences department. I teach mostly sociology and criminal justice classes. I'm a part of the Criminal Justice Academy program, which runs out of John Jay College. So we give them the first 60 credits that they need in order to transfer to John Jay. And a lot of them go on to have careers in criminal justice. And, you know, criminal justice is the second largest growing field in the country right now. So there's work. You know, there's definitely work out there for them. But besides that, and what's interesting is that with my current research on race and racism, I obviously have to discuss a lot about the criminal justice system and policing, police brutality, how racism is kind of built into those institutions. And so I'm always in this existential crisis about, like, man, there's kind of this broken criminal justice system. And I'm teaching students, and I'm giving them the credits to get into that profession. And so I feel like it's my duty to give them a particular sociological perspective on crime. Like, it's not just about good guys and bad guys. It's about understanding how people end up in the criminal trades, how an average person turns to crime.
And are you finding that your students have more of an interest these days in fixing a broken system or participating in the system as it is? How much change are they advocating for?
I think the overwhelming majority of students recognize it as a job where they're likely to get hired. And it's like their philosophy is like a distant second or third for a lot of them.
Okay.
But then many students, you know, after a class or two, many students are like, you know what? I want to be a police officer. If I'm going to be a police officer, I'd like to be a police officer that's there to do the right thing, not just to have power. Because, I mean, listen, I come across students that say, like, yeah, I want to be a police officer because it feels powerful. I'm like, that's not the right motivation. Yeah.
That's a great entree to your documentary that you're working on. Tell me the title of the documentary and why you've chosen to focus on that perspective.
Yeah. The title Modern Racism, it's funny because it's kind of been a working title for about 4 years now, and it just hasn't changed. And so The reason I'm calling it modern racism is because, you know, it kind of began as like, I want to do this historical exploration of how institutional racism came to be, the laws that propped up white supremacy in the United States. But I think a lot of times what's left out of the conversation with race and racism is that it still currently exists. There's a modern day version of it. You know, people might not be, you might not hear about lynchings and cross burnings as much as in the past, but there are certainly, we have to have a large amount of conversations around privilege, around implicit bias, and around essentially how we are all swimming in this water that is American society. And that water is filled with racist beliefs. It's very difficult not to have a race-based mentality while growing up in this culture. One of the reasons that I'm calling it modern racism is because I like to look into the future of these things. You know, we assume that racism is, either people assume that racism is gone or that he won't evolve. And we have, like, you know, individuals like myself who are biracial. There's this prediction that, like, most of America will be biracial by 2050. And again, people do this thing where they're like, racism will end in 2050 because we'll all be biracial. And my take on it is like, no, it'll just be different. But it'll probably still be there. You know, as long as we use race as a criteria for that, things are definitely going to remain the same.
When does modern racism begin? When do you define the modern racism as a starting point?
That's a really interesting question. You want to know something? All right. You know what? I would, because I've never thought about it that way, but I feel like I could answer that question. I would say that the 1970s, okay, with the beginning of the modern criminal justice system. And there's several things that happened all in the same decade. You had massive deindustrialization in the United States, which caused joblessness, which caused massive amounts of job loss, which caused, it started to lead to urban decay. It started to lead to inner city crime, which then led to the response with the modern criminal justice system, where we quadrupled the number of people in prison since the year of 1980. And the modern version, yeah. And you know what? Also, I think I could probably pin it a little bit to Reaganism, where probably the 1980s was the first time that people wanted to kind of dog whistle things and say things with a little bit more political correctness. You know, you couldn't speak about a particular ethnicity anymore and say bad things about them, but you can make implications about, like, welfare queens, and you can make implications about animals that are roaming the streets and causing crime. And I think the modern version of racism today is, it's more implied. It's more, you know, it's less straightforward. And it's interesting too, that, like, there's probably a very small handful of people in the United States today that would proudly claim to be a racist. That's not something that, it's a label that nobody wants nowadays. And so as a result of the language, we start to shift the way that we talk about, the way that we talk about race and ethnicity.
But certainly in the last 2 years, last 18 months, last 12 months, it's been very blatant. We've seen it on our media daily. So how has it shifted just in such a short period of time from being something that you describe as being more implicit to being very explicit?
Back to being explicit again. I think ground zero for today and ground zero for a lot of this stuff is the election of Barack Obama. It's 2008. And how it was interesting, because you had, let's say half. You had half of the country that said, we did it.
Right.
We got over. We got over the hump. This is it. Like, racism's going to end now. We've elected a Black president. This racism's over. And I think you had another half of the country that was sitting quietly and then suddenly saw the election of Barack Obama as this call to arms. Like, this is it. Like, now the liberals are really taking over. Now the multiculturalists are really taking over. And I'm not sure exactly how relevant this is to your question, but I had just recently finished a podcast on this book called The Turner Diaries. And The Turner Diaries is, it's if you know nothing about it, and I warn everybody, like, don't buy this book because it's a book that, like, honestly, like, it, like, gets you on a list of people to be watched. Because it's considered to be the Bible of the Bible of the racist right. And in the book, it's kind of this fantasy about, it's written in 1978, it takes place in the 1990s, and it's about this fantasy of, like, liberals taking over the country, and they kind of push people to this breaking point where they take away everybody's guns, and everybody in government starts to become people of color. And the original white founders of the nation suddenly feel like, well, our country is being stripped of us, and we as white people are an endangered species. And so, like, after reading that book, it started, like, Trumpism started to make a lot more sense. Proud Boys started to make a lot more sense. A lot of these, like, modern white supremacist groups, it almost seems as if they're following that playbook, and they saw, and in the book, it's almost like they're waiting for this moment for liberals to tip the scale where people can't take it anymore because they need the sentiment of the majority of the people. And so Barack Obama becomes this moment where it's like, this is it. This is the moment. This is where we start to rebel. And that rebellion makes its way to the election of Trump, who is the anti-Obama. Trump spends his entire presidency focusing on Obama. And I was just thinking about it this morning. I'm like, what did Trump accomplish? Like, what were some of the things that his entire focus was just undoing what Obama did. And that was kind of playing to the crowd. And yes, absolutely. Trump started to understand that you could say very xenophobic things, anti-Muslim, anti-Mexican, anti-Black. There's even a part in this book where they describe Black hoodlums in Chicago invading the suburbs. And it was really interesting to hear Trump say the exact same thing just 6 months ago. And so that's, yes, white supremacy has definitely made a comeback. Although I would look at it as, you have people who were, like, kind of quiet before, and now they felt like they had to speak up and say something because they thought that their country was being taken from them.
The project, the documentary that you started 4 years ago, how far are you along in its production, or at least in its pre-production? And bring us up to date on that project.
Sure. I would say it's still in a pre-production phase because I've had to restructure what it was about. I started this, it's all right. So 4 years ago, I started it as almost like a memoir. I just wanted to focus on myself and my upbringing and my family. I come from a biracial background. My father's Black and my mother's white. And so I felt like I had a unique perspective and unique experiences to offer on race. I make this joke that, like, because I'm Black and white, I get to talk crap about both groups without any consequence. But then it evolved into much more of an academic piece where I started to interview, because I had these questions about, like, all right, so race is a social construct. Race is something that we created. But then anytime I teach that or anytime I say that, well, people will line up a Black person and white person and then say, like, can't you see, there's a difference. Can't you see the difference? And so I wanted to look at, well, what are the truths behind our genetic mutations? So I started to interview some evolutionary biologists. I started to interview some geneticists. And then I started to interview other race scholars and other sociologists. And I just, like, for each subject within the film, I wanted to grab an expert and have them talk about it. You know, similarly to, like, how I would do a book, when I'm book writing and I'm doing a literature review, I'll just quote the person. And I was going to, like, start quoting people in the film. And I'm like, why would I quote them? Let me just go interview them. And in this past year, I've started to turn back towards ethnography, where I wanted to get down to that ground level and see who's doing anti-racist work on a much more community level, and to see the work that's being done. So I have right now the film is, I'm filming it. I've done a lot of interviews. I've done some filming, and it's like, I'm planning to wrap up all the filming part of it by this summer. And, you know, hopefully I could turn around the production a year after that.
Without giving anything away to your production, though, can you talk to me a little bit about the people who are doing the anti-racist work at the moment? What are they focusing on? Where are their main efforts?
Sure. I mean, I don't mind giving anything away. it kind of depends. Like there's three organizations that I'm working with now, and I'm hoping to pull in a couple more. There's this one organization in Minneapolis who literally, as a response to the killing of George Floyd, decided, all right, we could sit out here and protest every day, or we could start looking at like these underserved communities. And so there's this one organization in Minneapolis that I'm about to start filming with, that is they're focusing on, you know, food deserts, hunger, food drives. They're focusing on, you know, some education efforts. And the idea is that like they fight racism by fighting the symptoms of racism. There's another organization in New Orleans that I'm working with who is literally, they do anti-racism training. Like they train colleges, they train high school students, they train community members. Their entire focus is to make an audience aware of how institutional racism works and what can be done to dismantle it. And then I have a third organization here in New York City, who's honestly, their focus is on gun violence and violence disruption. And so each organization kind of is like treating a symptom. And then, you know, so it's great that I could do that ethnography that deals with each of those individual symptoms. And then I can come in with that nice sociological helicopter view there afterwards.
Tell me about your pathway to Queensborough and your education background.
In 2000, I had started a graduate program at the New School for Social Research. It's interesting too, because I'd gotten a master's in sociology. I wasn't sure that I wanted a PhD, but right after I did the master's, I was like, let's keep going. And my dream was just to be a researcher. My dream was to just like work in an office, create my own research projects, and then basically just get out and do ethnography. And this is a long time ago now, maybe 2003. I taught my first class at Hunter College. And I tried it. I had a colleague of mine that's like, you should try it. You should see what it's like to teach. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't think I want to be a professor. I don't want to do that. And I tried it and I loved it. Like completely fell in love with it. And I probably should have mentioned this first, that like I come from a social work background, and there's, forgive me, I can't remember where this parable comes from, but there's a parable about a man who's like standing by a riverbank, and he sees somebody drowning as they come down the river. So he dives in and saves the person. And he sees another person coming down the river. He dives in and saves the person. A third person, he dives in and saves the person. And then eventually he says to himself, what is going on upstream? I need to walk upstream to see why all these people are drowning. And so I felt like the first part of that parable is me doing social work. And then eventually I want to study sociology. I want to understand how these conditions are made. So like my dissertation research was based off of my social work career, working with at-risk youth, working with adolescents who had committed felony offenses. And again, not dividing up the world into good guys and bad guys, but dividing up the world into people that just make a wrong turn somewhere. Yeah. And I think that's the greatness of sociology, was like getting, studying and looking at these things. And I did have another assistant professor position at SUNY Old Westbury. I was there for 5 years. And then I switched into the CUNY system, and I haven't looked back.
Your background is so varied, and you've seen such different parts of our society. Where do you think the next 5 years are going to take you? What do you want to delve into and spend more time with?
Ooh, me personally? I'd like to finish this film. I imagine that once this film is complete, I'll probably have enough material for another book. I wouldn't mind authoring another book after this. But generally speaking, I want to continue in this line of both studying race scholarship and really getting into the minutia of like how racism works, and then how to kind of undo and untangle that mess as well. Because I feel like that's the biggest thing missing in the research is reconciliation. I think people love just pointing out the bad guys and pointing out people that are doing bad things. But I'm like, no, I think it's more important to understand where someone who is in that category comes from. You know, I'm the type of person that thinks like, you know, a David Duke or a Richard Spencer. I'm not about canceling them. I'm like, I want to try to hear what they have to say. I'm not going to agree with them ever. I'm never going to agree with them. But I want for a moment just to understand where they're coming from. I want to know how they got from point A to point B, because if you can understand that path, then you could understand how to take apart these things as well. And I'm also kind of seeing a career in studying masculinity as well. I feel like that's also necessary going into this decade. And I compare the two a lot, especially when I talk about, if I were to bring up something like white privilege, in order to get people to understand what white privilege is, I'll do this parallel of what male privilege is. And suddenly, you know, students might understand it a little bit better. So I like that intersectionality between those two things. And I would like to continue, but in the next 5 years, for sure. Those are the two things.
I would imagine that you draw a lot of strength and inspiration from your students and the personal circumstances that they come from. But who do you look up to? Who's your mentor in your field? Where do you draw your inspiration to do your work?
There's the co-author of The Con Man, who is actually a professor of mine. So he's definitely a mentor to me. Otherwise, it's the scholars in the field. If I'm lucky, I can get in touch with them and get a hold of them. Eduardo Benilla Silva is in Duke University. You know, I've interviewed him before. There's a lot of great things to say. You know, I read a lot of the work of Ta-Nehisi Coates. Beyond that, it's kind of just like bouncing ideas off my colleagues. I'm definitely every once in a while when I think I have something figured out and I'm like, I'm an expert in this thing now. Somebody comes along and offers a perspective where I'm like, I have a lot more to learn. I have a lot more to think about now. So I do appreciate bouncing ideas off my colleagues and others in the field that are studying this stuff, because there's always something to learn, always something.
Can any organization, can any society get to the point where they reach equity? Or is that always something that you have to strive for?
Well, I'll say this, that like equity is achievable. And I remember my point from before. Equity is achievable just by acknowledging the mess that's there. So, you know, take like colorblindism, for example. This was something that was, you know, big in the 90s. And, you know, like, I don't see color. I only see people. And that actually did more damage than good, because by removing yourself from the conversation, because that's what colorblindism does. You know, like if someone says, no, I'm colorblind, I don't see color, I see people. What they're saying to you is that I no longer want to be a part of the conversation. It's kind of the same thing that a lot of people said with the election of Biden. Oh, because we're replacing Trump with Biden, racism's over again. We're doing it again. we're like, it's over. So, you know, I think that first step towards equity is acknowledgement. Let's acknowledge that there's a cleanup to be done. I use this metaphor a lot of like, okay, so world hunger. We can end world hunger by ignoring it. Nope. We can end global climate change by pretending that it's not there. Nope. You have to acknowledge that it's there. And this is kind of the struggle that we have with half of Congress right now, is to get them to acknowledge that global climate change is a problem, and then we do the cleanup for it. And so with race and racism and the inequities that exist, we have to recognize that those inequities exist, and then we could start to do the cleanup and move towards greater equity.
Well, Trevor, I've really enjoyed our conversation. I love the the detail and the intricacies that you get into when you're looking at other cultures. I'm looking forward to your DACA when it comes out. There's a trailer that we'll connect people to so they can see it. And I'm very appreciative of you, your time, and sharing so much with us. Thank you.
All right. No, I thank you. Thank you for having me very much. Thank you.